Very good evening to everyone who has joined in. I'm Dr. Neeraj Mankad, Assistant Dean at Flame University and also a faculty at the School of Business. Welcome to this fourth masterclass series. As many of you are aware, some of you I know are coming in for quite a few webinars. Thank you for that. I hope you are getting something out of it. Masterclass series, we started off as a means of offering a corporate learning suite wherein specific topics are being taken by our expert faculty, and we try to connect that with what's happening in the global scenario these days. So it's my pleasure today to once again have my good friend and colleague Darshan Doshi here with us. Darshan was here a couple of weeks ago, and today he's going to give talk to us regarding effectuation for today's uncertain times. Effectuation, a very powerful technique, and I'm not going to say too much about it, but I'm sure it's something which all of us can certainly use given the context that we have here. For some of you who may be joining us for the first time, haven't heard about Darshan. Darshan is the director of Flame Center for Entrepreneurship and Innovation. Apart from that, he wears multiple hats and has several accolades to his credit. Darshan is a part of the Thai in the Indus Entrepreneurs Group for a very long time. He is a graduate of the Babson College and has also been honored to be on the part of the advisory board of Babson Collaborative, which is a global advisory board. So good going there, Darshan, on that. Darshan is also an entrepreneur. So he sort of perhaps walks the talk, and therefore is one of the good persons to let us give a sound introduction to what effectuation is and taking it further. So without much ado, Darshan, I'm going to hand this over to you. Good luck to you. Before we begin, just a small sort of housekeeping announcement for the attendees here. We have the Q&A section open up. Darshan will be taking his presentation about, I think, 40, 45 minutes. And then we will follow it up with a Q&A section. Please keep on raising your questions and we will take them up once the session is over. All yours, Darshan. Go ahead.
Great. Thanks a lot. Good evening, everyone. I hope you're enjoying the beautiful weather. Here we have in Pune, the rains have just started earlier this week. But also the downside of having rains is that we could potentially have power cuts. We had another webinar that I was a part of earlier today. And unfortunately, just experienced a power cut. So if the power cut, if there is a power cut and if I log off, just give me a minute and I should be back and I should be able to pick it up from there. Great to be here, and thanks for taking time to join on a Thursday evening. I want to make this 1 hour useful, right? And so from that point of view, just wanted to use this a way to share my learnings about effectuation, right? I've been fortunate where under the guidance of Dr. Saras Saraswati, who did the research, who did the heavy lifting and coined the term effectuation, right? It's a form of logic for decision making. I've been able to implement it in my own life and then also ran workshops or effectuation programs for entrepreneurs or aspiring entrepreneurs, right? So I want to bring that to the table today. And I think effectuation works beautifully in uncertain times when you cannot predict, right? And if 2020 has shown us one thing is that you might have planned, and why don't you go back to December 31st and see what were the goals for 2020 and what happened in the last 6 months, right? We are 6 months into the year and we still, most people don't know what's going on, right? You're still dealing with this uncertainty. But life goes on. How do we make best use of what we have? And that's what essentially effectuation talks about. What I'm going to do is I'm going to have a quick poll over here so that I understand who the audience member is. So You should see this poll right now in front of you. If you could take maybe the next 10 seconds to just quickly answer, what's your background, right? Are you a professional? Are you an entrepreneur? Are you a master's student? Are you an undergrad student? So then I'll fine tune this, this workshop as much as possible. Okay, so so about 80% have voted so far, and about 45% are undergrad students, 35% are professionals, 16% are entrepreneurs, and 3% are master's students. So that's good to know. And then I want to have another poll, right, just to understand what your expectations are from this session. So you should see another poll in front of you. Maybe you could take the next few seconds to just answer, you know, what is it that you're expecting from this webinar? You could choose multiple options. This is, you could choose all three if you wanted to. But this just gives me a better idea as to, you know, what frame of mind you're coming into this session. So I can hopefully be add give you at least one takeaway from this next 1 hour. Perfect. So most of you are looking at learning about better decision making, which is what effectuation is, and learning how to deal with uncertainty. Great. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to share my screen. So that you can see my slide deck. Just give me a minute. Can you just confirm, Neeraj bhai, if you can see my screen, the presentation?
Yes, Darshan, please go ahead.
Perfect, perfect. Okay, so so here's how I plan to run this this session, right? We have about 45 more, 50 odd minutes. I want to use the last 10 minutes, 15 minutes for Q&A. And the first few minutes, just understanding your background and what you're looking for. I want to run you through the concept of dealing with uncertainty with the point of view of using effectuation. You know, what is effectuation? What does it mean? What are the principles? How can you apply it? And then right after that, I want to do a quick 5 minute exercise where you can deal or use effectuation with your uncertainty that you may be facing now. All right, so it's not a full-fledged workshop, but given the time, I hope you're able to at least get some value out of this session. All right, so, you know, India is just at a high level, you know, India is moving towards a $5 trillion economy. We don't know whether it's gonna be 25 or 20, 30, right? It doesn't matter. What matters is we are moving in that direction, which means we are almost doubling our economy. Doubling your economy means more opportunities for people to make more companies like Reliance, like Flipkart, like Tata's, amongst others, right? If that's what you're looking for. The downside of it is we have a huge population who are unemployed. Or we need to create almost 10 million jobs a year from now through till 2040. Where are those jobs going to come from? You know, you have the large conglomerates, the large companies, but for them as well to absorb this much amount of these many new jobs is going to be unlikely. So then the next source of jobs is going to come through job creators or entrepreneurs. Right, so new companies being hiring a lot of the masses. We have already seen that. We've also seen the downside of it, where in COVID-19, a lot of people have been let go. Right, and most of these have been the venture-funded startups because they need to use their cash flow to survive and then to grow. On the other hand, India is the third largest startup ecosystem in the world. We have 70,000 startups. We have 9,000 tech startups. We've had $13 billion of venture capital funding in the last year. And India has 24 startup unicorns, you know, billion-dollar valuations. But many of them are facing challenges. You know, even 50, 60-year-old companies with billions of dollars in revenue are facing problems today due to COVID-19. But then these problems are also new opportunities, right? So let me just walk you through what are some of these problems that we are facing today, right? COVID-19 has changed the world. Are we in an economic recovery? Are we going to have a V-shaped recovery? The markets seem to show that. Are we in recession? The US has published that it is in recession. Or are we moving towards depression? You might have heard a lot of articles about India where we might potentially have already been in recession moving towards depression, right? And what that means is a lot of people losing jobs, right? A lot of businesses shutting down. And it's a tough situation altogether for most people, right? Most businesses, because it's strained or it's put a lot of constraints. And these are some examples that you can see, you know, who's laid off a lot of people. But at the same time, you know, historically, we've seen a lot of high value or high growth companies being created during crisis. You know, here are some examples. More recently, you know, you could see Salesforce, Google, Facebook, Slack, MailChimp coming out of the last financial crisis. Previous financial crisis, some of the big ones, Electronic Arts, Microsoft, Disney, General Motors, Trader Joe's, right? So I think some of these opportunities can be turned around, crisis can be turned around into opportunities. Right? What are some of the problems which are being looked at opportunities in the Indian startup ecosystem today? I'm pretty active in the Indian and the US startup ecosystem, either running accelerators or being an advisor to many startups or being an investor, right? So many of the largest companies pivoted to groceries and essential goods over the last 2 months, right? Companies such as Zomato saying we're going to do grocery deliveries. Well, that is being opportunistic, right? Safety, many existing family businesses started creating sanitizers, PPE, ventilators, robots. Then you've seen India, government of India coming out with Arogya Setu and some of the other tracking apps, right? Remote work connectivity, the fact that we are on Zoom today, right? Indian government putting out an initiative saying, you know, we want a locally grown Zoom equivalent in India. That's an opportunity, right? Cybersecurity, so many threats coming out through, you know, so many people coming online at the same time. Healthcare. If we could have someone come up with a vaccine, right? I think everybody, some of the largest pharmaceutical companies are pursuing that. Government of India saying, you know, build in India, build for India, be vocal about local, right? Some of the SaaS community members talking, build in India for the world. SaaS, software as a startup, is one of probably the least impacted industries so far, but it has also been impacted, right? EdTech taking off. Right, a lot of my kids are now using Zoom and Padlet and whatnot, right, to go through their schooling, and that's begun. Personal finance, a lot of people rethinking their investments, they are rethinking their net worth, rethinking how is it that they're going to meet their ends. So I think there are a lot of mental health, you know, again, this is a big opportunity that's come through right now. And you'll see a lot more funding go into mental health startups as well. A lot of initiatives taken by various stakeholders, you know, government, startup communities, companies, philanthropists, a lot of focus coming now back on profitability versus, you know, growth at all costs. Rising debt, what happens to MSMEs? What happens to freelancers, right? It's a tough situation, but also people are doing things to tackle this this situation. So now I want to walk you through, you know, what really is uncertainty, right? Uncertainty essentially means you cannot predict. Uncertainty means you don't know. If A happens, then B happens, right? That is prediction. You know, one of the best case scenarios is the stock market. If you think you could have predicted it, you could have made a fortune of the stock markets if you would have invested back in March and then liquidated now, or you know, sold your stocks now. But you don't know. You don't know what's going on today. Banking sector faces similar challenges. So you know, we can't predict everything. Even trading, in which there is high level of prediction, right? Even traders today, like physical goods traders, chemical goods traders, they are the ones, even they don't know what's going on, right? In the last 2.5 months, we don't know what who's going to buy, how do we manage logistics, how do we, are we going to get payments, payments on time, right? So if you know and you can predict, put your money, right? Go all in and see and make a lot of money, right? And if you don't, and you're dealing with uncertainty, then you need to effectuate, right? And what is effectuation? I'll walk you through it. And if you're in doubt whether you can predict or you can't predict, you know, use effectuation. I think that's the simple takeaway. And then there are some people, you know, who will say, well, I want to take the lead. I want to take charge. I want to be in control of my destiny. I want to be taking actions, but I just, you know, there's too much volatility. So I'm not going to do anything. I'm just going to sit back and relax. Well, in a way, that's okay, right? You need to know who you are. But if you are someone who wants to take an initiative, wants to capture the opportunity through the problems, then, you know, some of these are the reasons that are given by people who've not been able to do. I don't know what to do. It's okay that you don't know what to do, but then I'm going to walk you through a framework which will hopefully enable you to minimize risk, minimize your loss, right? The downside, and take charge, right? And take some actions, so that you can continue moving and not stall. So, you know, Dr. Sara Saraswati, she's been a mentor advisor to me. She's an advisor at the Flame Center for Entrepreneurship and Innovation as well. She's one of the top entrepreneurship educators and researchers. She did a research on expert entrepreneurs. So, you know, entrepreneurs who have at least 15 years experience founding and running companies, multi-million dollar companies, at least who have had at least one IPO and multiple ventures, including successes and failures. So she shadowed them for 5 years to understand how do they make decisions, right? And she came up with 5 simple principles, which I'm going to walk you through. And it's too simple in nature, but applying them is where the magic happens, right? So before we get into effectual logic, what is it that a lot of the management principles teach us? If A happens, then B happens, right? Because historically that situation has taken place. Now, COVID-19, this situation has taken place, but mostly before anyone who's alive today, right? 1918. And a lot of people have gone back to learn from history. Well, how did people, how did cities, how did countries, how did businesses tackle such a situation? But there's not a lot of material on it, right? So let's take an example where financial crisis, if it happened as it is again, right, then you could potentially use part of causal logic, which is, I know what's happened, let me predict, let me control. And you'll see the US Fed has acted slightly in that way, saying that, look, let me bring in some liquidity into the market, right? And at least make sure or avoid a catastrophic, illiquid situation in the market. But we don't know whether that's right. Second part is, to the extent that we can control the future, we don't need to predict. So what Dr. Saras says is, let's remove prediction out of our equation. We are not going to predict. We are not going to set a goal and then do reverse engineering, right? Which is what essentially we do in a lot of the management lessons, right? Management lessons, you set a goal, you gather resources, and then go towards that goal to qualify, because we say, look, if A happens, then B happens, then C happens, then D happens. But what effectuation does is says, no, let's not set a goal. Let's see who we are, what we are. And then based on what resources, what means we have, let us do something, right? And then the part of co-creation comes in as well. Please send in your questions. I'll walk through this and then I'll try to tackle the questions as well at the end. So here's a 2x2 framework, right? on your left hand side, you have prediction, right? Is it low prediction, high prediction, and how much control? And so if you have high prediction and high control, you are a visionary. If you have low prediction and low control, you need to be adaptive. If you have high prediction, low control, right, then you can be predictive. But then the other side is, if you can't predict and you want high level of control, is where effectuation essentially comes in. So how do you control a future you can't predict? Well, you work with what's already within your control and co-create with it by bringing in self-selected stakeholders, not necessarily, getting everyone in together, your partners in together, so as to build something which is of meaning to you and the other stakeholder. So what are the five principles? Five principles, bird in hand. What do I have? Who do I know? What can I do? Right? You need to just write this down and say, look, this is Darshan Doshi. This is who I know. This is what I can do. And after I've jotted it down, then I say, well, what is my affordable loss? Personally, for me, affordable loss was a principle which was a big learning for me. What does affordable loss mean? If you're starting a new venture, it means I'm going to put in all my life savings, right? And make this startup succeed. What happens if it fails, right? Your complete savings are gone. Versus saying, I'm going to spend maximum of 18 months and a maximum of 20 lakh rupees. And within this time frame, I should be able to self-sustain through the business, right? Not a flamboyant lifestyle, but just self-sustain. And so when you put these affordable loss or limitations, right, then what happens is, even if you don't succeed and you fail, you don't lose it all, right? Now, this is slightly contrary to VC-funded startups. For them, it is either a zero, which is completely fail, or complete big win, right? Through millions of dollars or whatever it may be. Because mind you, a VC is looking to invest in with the point of view of getting over $100 million exit, right? Crazy Quilt. Let me give you an example. Crazy Quilt, basically, it's an American concept where everyone kind of comes together. They get their chadars, and then they stitch it together to make a nice, beautiful blanket, if I may call that, right? So it's a crazy quilt. What this means is, what is it that I know and I can do? And then I suppose I cannot build a website, right? And I want to bring in a stakeholder who knows how to build a website. So then his or her means come and join together with my means through self-selection with the same purpose or mission being aligned, right? And their affordable loss being taken care. Then you essentially create something by increasing your means, right? So Crazy Quilt essentially means asking and bringing onboarding various stakeholders. Lemonade principle. COVID-19 happened, right? A lot of people are using lemonade principle today. What lemonade principle means is that if you are given lemons, you make lemonade. If something wrong happens, you try to use in the situation that it is. And a lot of the small businesses, medium businesses, many of the family businesses, what they've done is, I have a workshop, I have some existing resources, labor, material. Let me see if I can make sanitizer. And a lot of the alcohol making companies, the smaller ones, they started making and selling sanitizers. A lot of the ones who made and sold cloth or t-shirts or pants and all, two large companies, they started making masks and aprons, which they have been selling, right? So essentially, that's what a lemonade principle is. And lastly, pilot in the plane, right? So pilot in the plane is essentially, if you don't take charge, if you don't take action, nothing's going to happen, right? And so it is very crucial to come back and to think again, saying that, look, you're essentially the person who's piloting and taking care or reaching out and doing what's necessary to move forward. Let's walk through an example. I think most people know Airbnb situation. Airbnb is one of the fastest, largest growing startups in the world. This is how it started, where Brian Chesky and Joe, they couldn't pay their rent in SFO. They had a room, they put airbeds, and they turned it into, you know, saying, well, this is what I know, this is what I have. Let me rent this out, so that sublet it out, so that way I can meet my rent. Amol over here, he was the first person, a first customer, to really just go on that bare bones website. And then, it was not called Airbnb that time, but essentially that's what it turned out to. The affordable loss principle, in extreme cases, you don't have money to invest, but you have your time, you have your energy, you have your efforts, you have your expertise that you can put in and not necessarily have a return in mind. Crazy quilt principle, build a network of self-selected stakeholders. You know, a lot of the management principles will say, well, you need to do your competitive analysis. Well, not really, right? In this case, if you're starting off small, you're taking, not necessarily trying to aim at, like $1 billion or $10 billion, but saying, well, let me just see what is it that I can do based on what I have. And so Brian and Joe knew Nathan, who was a great engineer, and he's essentially the guy who they brought on board to build the initial days or the initial technology, the software. Here's an interesting example. You know, back in 2008, Obama and McCain were going for the presidential election. These guys put their own branding to get more people. So they made these box of cereals, and they got about $30,000 of funding so they could continue working on what they are doing, right? Still not enough, right? So they had a lot of leftover cereal, which they kind of consumed. But going down, they joined Y Combinator, which is one of the best top accelerator programs in the world, changed their name to Airbnb. They got funding from Sequoia, still no traction, right? We are talking about Airbnb in its early days, still not getting enough traction. How do you get people to come and stay in strangers' houses, right? If you try to do that in India today, it's still a tough ask for due to our culture, due to our society norms, right? So imagine being the first one to do that. Leverage the surprises. So what they did was they actually flew to New York City. They would go in the homes of the renters, take the photos, high quality, and then put them on the website. So really doing the hard work. That essentially kind of got their bookings growth. You know, so they had about 800% growth in 2010. And one of the main reasons for that was the quality of the photos, the images of the house in which the Airbnbs were kind of put up, right? Real story, I think. There are, I think, just over 100 odd cases. If you Google or if you go to effectuation.org, if you go on YouTube, you'll find enough examples of how effectuation has worked. I definitely encourage you to do this. So how do you tie all of these five principles together, right? We're at 5:30. I'll try to move a little fast so we can wrap this up in 15 minutes. So how do you co-create the future, right? So first is, who I am, who am I? What do I know? Whom do I know, right? I think knowing this is the starting point, rather than if you oppose this. The other way to say is, let me set the goal. So goal being, let me build a business in pharmaceutical or healthcare. Now, I'm a chemical engineer by background. I understand a little bit of technology. I have some experience within the chemicals, fertilizer, engineering business, software business. but what do I know about building a pharmaceutical company, right? So there's a, not a strong match over there. So you might want to, you know, if you set a goal saying, this is what I want to do, I want to come up with a vaccine, then that's probably an extreme example of, you know, where there is not a good founder market fit, right? If you flip it around and say, well, let me write down, let me know, let me see, what do I know, who do I know, what can I do? Then that becomes a great starting point. What do I have in my own hands, right? And then what is my lower limit, right? Meaning I want to start this business. Unless a first customer pays me 5 lakh rupees to build the product, I'm not going to build this product. This could be an affordable loss. Or I'm not going to spend more than a year. In a year, if I'm not earning more than 50,000 rupees a month, I'm going to fold this business, or I'm not going to do this, right? So you're essentially saying, what is your cutoff limit? And I think that's a very important principle to put in. Then you interact with people. You know, there is an ask framework, and that's a complete different workshop, which I'm not going to talk about. But how do you go and shamelessly ask people, right? A big part of being entrepreneurship or entrepreneurial, and today, you know, being entrepreneurial is very important as a mindset and as a skill set if you have to grow, is going and reaching out to people who you may not be comfortable, you know, getting a no from. So interacting with people, there's a particular way of asking to improve your conversion ratio, but essentially getting commitments, you know, and how do you differentiate between a verbal commitment versus an actual commitment, right? So what is the skin in the game? If someone's going to join, if someone says, okay, I'm going to be a customer, how do you know a customer is a customer, right? If it is your friend, right? Or if it is someone through your relatives. So I think making sure that, you know, there has to be a real commitment, a real skin in the game, a signed contract, an advance, time being dedicated X amount of hours. I think then that is the real commitment, making sure that the words match the actions, right? Essentially, that's what you want to see. And then based on that, you create new means, right? And then this feeds into your cycle of co-created resources, right? You get more means if more people come together, more. An example of this is, you know, I've recently launched a 1-year postgraduate program in entrepreneurship and innovation at Flame University, right? Co-created this by bringing in Dr. Arvind Sinsure, who's one of the innovation gurus. Then a pool of 40 to 50 mentors, investors, educators, coming in together. Babson College coming in as a partner, Thai Pune coming in as a partner, Your Story coming in as a partner, right? So suddenly my means are high, and I can create a program which will meet the requirements of what I'm trying to create. So it suddenly it becomes, rather than what I know, who do we know? What do we know? What can we do? And then you can set a goal, right? So rather than first starting with the goal, you start with what you have, with your means, and then set a goal. And then from that, you'll get some amount of constraints. I can't do this. We can't do this. What do we do, right? And then you'll get some surprises like COVID-19. And then that is how essentially new markets are created, right? Or new solutions are created. So slightly theoretical, if you want to see some of the, typically an effectuation is a 2-day or a 3-week shop, right? Where we go through a series of things, or it is a 10-week program as well, right? Over the weekend. But if you want to learn more, you can definitely just go online, effectuation.org, and you can learn more about this. And I'll send a follow-up email, which will contain this presentation, as well as some other links and resources that you can take a look at. So what happens with all of this, right? From a performance standpoint, if you succeed, you'll come up with something new. If you don't, well, you've not really lost significantly. You've not lost it all, right? You can recover. You can still get your footing and you can start again. Then you can move to plan B, right? So I think this is another way, which I think is a better way when you cannot predict the future, right? you may be a professional, you may be a student, you may be an entrepreneur, but there's a lot of uncertainty for everyone in what they do, right? So being entrepreneurial, having that mindset, having this ability to deal with uncertainty is very, very important. So that takes practice. You know, it takes a lot of practice because we are a slave to our habits and our behaviors. So if you want to change your behavior, change your habits, it takes a conscious effort, which may take a few days, which may take a few months, few years. But essentially, I think putting this to practice, being conscious about it is very, very crucial. So your turn. Okay, what we are going to do is we are at 5:40. Take 5 minutes to write down, you know, what is it that you know? What is it? Who you are, right? What is your expertise? What is your experience? And whom do you know? And then write down what is your affordable loss, right? And make a list of people who you need to reach out to by this weekend, right? Very, very quick way of putting all of this theory into practice. So you're dealing with some sort of uncertainty. Whatever that uncertainty is, write it down bold, right? Upfront. And then just quickly jot down few points so that you have some as a starting point in which you can then deep dive after this workshop, after this session. Okay, so just take the next 3 to 4 minutes to jot this down. I'll take a look at some of your questions in the meantime. So just take maybe another minute or two, just quick notes, you know, just some pointers that you can put in. Krishna, you've questioned, you know, what does stakeholder commitment mean? What stakeholders means are a group of people who are important if you have to move or if you have to succeed, right? So for example, you want to start a business, you're good at sales, but you don't know how to build a product. And just for sake of ease, you are trying to build an e-commerce website. And here's me who can build, say, a Shopify website over a weekend. And you can do the sales, right? Whether it is digital marketing, digital sales, and the logistics and the operations. So you reach out to me and say, well, hey, Darshan, you know, this is something that I'm looking at. Are you interested? And then we have a conversation and I say, well, yes, really, I am interested. And we've got an understanding in place on how we are going to share the profits or how we are going to work together. And what is my job and what is your job, right? And then based on that, you follow through and I follow through. A way to show that there is a commitment, best way to say is whether have I really built that website for you or not, right? That's essentially the job to be done. But some sort of agreement or a contract which you and I sign off upfront is a sign of commitment. And then whether that really translates into you know, success or not is dependent on few other factors, right? Like which involves you doing your job and actually selling those products and taking care of the operations, right? So I think that's a example of a stakeholder commitment. Okay, we'll get into the other questions. I'm just going to quickly share and walk through a few of the other slides. So I hope, you know, very quickly you're able to at least jot down some thoughts around you know, dealing with the uncertainty that you have today. Okay. My suggestion is continue doing this after the webinar. so that it's fresh in your mind. Or once you receive an email which contains all of these resources, you can look it up, you can reference them, and then you can work further so that you have clarity and you have an action plan. Okay? So just moving forward, I want to use the next 2-3 minutes to share what is it that we do. Okay, I joined just over 2.5 years ago as the founding director for the Center for Entrepreneurship and Innovation. We had a minor and a major at Flame University, both undergrad and postgrad level. I came in with the vision to build an entrepreneurial village to help startups. Right. So, and these are the various initiatives on the right hand side. On the left hand side are some of the examples of our startups. So far, 19 startups, revenue generating startups, have gone through our accelerator program, which is called Flame Origins Program. We've had a lot of entrepreneurship summits. We have a beautiful co-working space. We have an incubator for students. We have an inspirational talk series, which is called Flame Pathblazer series. Right. And like I mentioned earlier, we've also launched a one-year postgraduate program in entrepreneurship and innovation. The applications are still open. We are expecting to start this program end of August, depending on, you know, UGC guidelines. But essentially, this is what the program looks like, right? This is for people who've launched their businesses and want to grow it. Part of family businesses who want to start their own division within that family business. Or aspiring entrepreneurs who don't even have an idea but want to use a year to see how far can they take that idea, okay, or come up with an idea. And the way we've done it is, you know, the program centers around learning by doing. We've got 4 modules. We've got, you work with, you know, funded startups as a project. You're part of the incubator. We have a partnership where we'll do an immersion in Pune, Bangalore, Mumbai, Delhi, Hubli, and Babson. Okay, we spend about a week in Boston as well. And then there are a lot of competitions which you can be a part of and get benefit and guidance from investors and entrepreneurs. These are our faculty, mentors, advisors, you know, some of the big names, as you can see, you know, these are all people who I have worked with you know, been fortunate to get their guidance and support in this initiative. Like I said, we also have Babson Collaborative, we have Thai Pune and Vadwani Foundation supporting this initiative. We've also got Thai, Your Story, supporting this initiative. To learn more, you know, visit effectuation.org. So I'm going to stop sharing my slide, and just, you know, quickly say, well, short time, we have another 15 minutes. We can go through it. Dr. Neeraj, if there's anything that you think I should add more to it, very happy to do so. Let me just take the questions that are there. Okay.
Yeah, I'm good.
Okay. So Kunal, sir, what if we are quite certain of the future and we are ready to invest in a project, but the situation worsens? Then you're really not certain, right? I mean, there's a doubt over there. That's uncertainty. So that's essentially, you know, what you want to do. Prediction means you predict India is going to win and India actually wins. Whereas there is a 50-50% chance of it to lose, right? Depending on the day. So Kunal, your question is a classic question of dealing with uncertainty. How do I know that this is not going to worsen? We all seeing the stock markets going at an all-time high. And that has got no or zero, little correlation with what's the reality on the ground, right? I mean, granted, markets are forward-looking, but where's the reality? Are we going to see another lockdown by government of India? We don't know. So what do we do then, right? What happens if cases increase? So I think that's dealing with uncertainty, but taking it head on. And trying to create something using the situation. And that's essentially what the 5 principles and the process of effectuation helps us answer. In view of uncertainties, the confidence level goes very low. How to build risk taking ability, knowing fully well that we are living in a black swan phase? Fantastic question, right? How to take risk-taking ability fully well, affordable loss? You know, what is your risk capability? What is your risk appetite? At what point do you walk away? I'm advising this one startup out of the US. It's in the fitness space. She's fantastic in the sense that she's a fitness instructor, multiple certifications. She's got existing clients. But she wants a digital learning or fitness coaching app. All right. I asked her a simple question, you know, at what point do you walk away in terms of money, in terms of time? And there was no clear answer, right? What happens in that case? In that case, do you put all your savings in? Because do you put good money over bad money? Do you continue working on it for a year, 18 months? So you need to have that clarity. And I think this framework essentially helps you get that clarity as to, you know, who am I? What am I? What do I know? What is my affordability? Right? Putting that down is very crucial. Personally, like I said, I've been benefited immensely because of the affordable loss concept. So how do you build risk taking ability? You start small. Know what your means are, and you calibrate what is the upside versus the downside, right? And first you should start with what is the downside? Am I okay with the downside, right? So any new initiatives, anything new that you do, there are consequences out of it, right? If you want to get a good fit body, you need to work out. That means going through a lot of pain, okay? Pain of physical ache, good sleep, letting go of some of the food that you may enjoy eating, amongst many other things, right? So are you okay with the problems that come associated with those new initiatives, with your goals, right? I think that is very, very important, because human behavior is kind of tuned to saying, well, what's the upside? It's easy to think about the upside. I think we need to give equal respect to the downside and say, well, what really is the downside, right? And am I okay if I lose that much money, that much time, that much credibility, right? Or now is just not a good time. You know, the situation is that I need to do a job. I need to get a job. I don't have to worry. I need a steady income, right? Or I'm okay with 7% fixed deposit returns, right? Whatever it may be, right? What does incubator mean? Krishna, an incubator is, you know, within these universities, what you'll find is there are a few students who want to try their business idea, right? And so what an incubator does is it handholds you to building your business, working on your idea. So that's what an incubator means. Nikhil says, could you please share some insights for social entrepreneurs? How can we deal with it? I think social entrepreneurship is has the same amount of variables and uncertainties as any other entrepreneurs. Okay, so I would deal with social entrepreneurs the same way, like I said, as regular entrepreneurs. Who do you know? What do you know? What can you do? Is it about what is the impact, right? When I hear social entrepreneur, I hear impact, you know? So what is the impact that you want to have? Is it 1 million people? Is it one person? Is it the maid in your house? Is it your watchman? What is it, right? I think you need to define that, and then based on that, see what you can do. Nalin, how to factor in cost of exit in case same is required due to business situation or external factor like COVID? I don't quite exactly understand that. How do you factor in the cost of exit? Same is required due to business. Okay, so I don't know. Maybe are you asking that to further clarify? Does one need to keep some reserve to meet outstanding liabilities in case of closure of business? That's a tough question, Nalin. You know, I've had some experience with my family business, both when it was in its heydays and then when we decided to separate and close down one part of the business. I think COVID has taught us that if you are debt free, you get a lot more peace of mind. Okay, how do you need to keep some reserve to meet your liabilities? It's a no-brainer, right? Absolutely. Ideally, you wouldn't have any liabilities. You wouldn't take any debt. But cost of doing business, you need to probably look at it, right? So I don't know. Maybe we need to take this offline and see if I can help you out based on my experience. I'm very happy to. We'll have to know a lot more about it. Dr. Neeraj, feel free to jump in on that as well.
It's a tough call, I guess, in such situation, essentially. You know, when we talk of
closure of business, yeah.
Businesses, we are talking about, keeping reserves, because I look at it from one perspective of an entrepreneur. And the mindset of an entrepreneur does not get or factor in, you know, closure of a business. So whatever are the sort of reserves that you have, you generally think that reserves are critical when you want to do expansions or, you know, sudden opportunities coming up and so on and so forth. So I'm not sure whether you would foresee the closure of the business and therefore, you know, put that.
Yeah, but it's a tough call.
It is a tough call.
Deepak bhai, thank you. You know, really, just want to do a quick poll over here. You know, the last poll, I promise, just to get some feedback on the session. I've launched the poll. If you can just quickly say, from a feedback, whether this was something useful or it wasn't, it could have been better. It can really help, right? What does cost of exit mean? Krishna, I think we'll take that question offline, if that's okay with you. You and I can set up another call if it is possible, right? Chandan, the principle of affordable loss is extremely useful. However, the counter could be if the fire in the belly to succeed might be a hit too, right? So another example from my life. Okay, one of my relatives believes that if you want to grow, you need to take on debt in your business. Okay, because then it pushes you to perform at your highest level. Okay, me on the other hand, that actually discourages me. Right, I love the fact that I have no debt, and so I can really, really do what I want, not having to worry about it. Right? Is my fire in the belly any lower? No, I don't believe so. Okay, so I think it is a very individualistic, personalized fire in the belly is necessary for you to achieve anything, right? It's desire. It's the desire to be rich, to be powerful, to be impactful, to be the best company in the country, to be the most funded, right? To be the highest growth company. I think everyone's wired differently. Finding your own place and knowing yourself, I think, is crucial, and that has been my learning as to where I stand in the various different behavior patterns or personalities. I think just getting to know who you are is crucial, but fire in the belly is necessary to succeed, for sure. Without that, there's no action, right? If there's no inspiration, there is no action. Great. So we are at 5:56. Neeraj bhai, if you want to take over and just give an overview of what's going to happen next. Everyone, I'll put in my email address If you want to reach out, please feel free to reach out. I'd be happy to answer any questions. And sure. We have the registration list, and I'll send this link with other resources with Dr. Neeraj, who can share it with you.
Yes. So what, as many of our attendees would already be knowing, we will, if they have come here earlier, we will be sending across the presentation that Darshan has made along with you know, the link that you can watch it on YouTube, where if you would could get in touch with Darshan, his connects would be available on LinkedIn. Please feel free to go ahead and you know, shoot out your questions to him there. Thank you so much, Darshan, on behalf of all the attendees who have come here. We've got some great reviews coming in. As usual, your session is a hit. So thank you once again for, you know, taking the second session. We hope to see you back in the masterclass series very soon with a different topic and some great insights from your work that you've been doing over the last so many years.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you. And to all of you, thank you so much for joining us, spending an hour with us, where we tried to curate as very short content on effectuation for you. Any one of you would like to look at it in more details, please, as I mentioned, feel free to go ahead and reach out to Darshan. He can connect with you and take it offline as well. Do join us for the next session of Masterclass on Creating Corporate Entrepreneurs by Professor Amarpreet Singh Grewal, who is a faculty of entrepreneurship. He will be joined by the department chair, Dr. Bharat Damani. They will be speaking on really how within corporates do you create a culture of entrepreneurship, and because that's something which we are seeing becoming very critical within organizations itself. So the fire in the belly, if I can use a phrase from Chandan, an attendee, is not just limited to entrepreneurs, but we also see that in corporate executives. And this session will essentially trying to look at you know, academic research and Amarpreet's own work that he has done during his PhD and otherwise, to look at ways of increasing entrepreneurship within organizations. So kindly register for that and do join us next week here. So once again, wishing you guys all a good evening, and thank you so much for joining. Thank you so much, Darshan, once again. Bye-bye.